Hi everybody, and welcome to Let's Play Kingdom Death Monster. It's time for a journey into the darkness. I'm of course joined by my fabulous host, Warren. Welcome to the show.
I'm ready for this.
And we are joined by the fabulous Chris Handley from Darker Days Radio, who will be guiding us as we take our first steps into this dark and twisted world.
Indeed. Guiding us. He's practically joining us. He's going to be one of the survivors. So it's the three of us versus whatever is going to be thrown at us.
Pretty much, yes. I am going to be getting maimed and injured along with you while showing you what wonders we can hunt.
Yeah. Well, you know, we're all in this together, eh?
Right. I'm going to give you a piece of advice, Warren. Don't, Leroy.
Okay, well, we'll see what happens. Right, so describe to us where we are. This is the very, very introductory steps now we're going to take in this.
This is the initial story for Kingdom Death, the initial hunt. So we are these survivors, and we've chosen to name them after ourselves.
Yep. Okay.
So, this is me.
Yep.
This is Chris.
Yep.
This is you.
Yep.
And this is an extra one who we named Abby.
Yeah. Abby. Okay. So Warzan has blue hair in this one then. Okay.
Yeah. And these unfortunate souls have woken up in this nightmare world, and it's complete darkness. The only thing they have with them are their loincloths, their cloths, and they have lanterns that are the only things that can illuminate the world that are possibly tied to their souls. I'm not too sure. There are many mysteries in the setting. And of course, the entire surface of the world of Kingdom Death, as you can see on the board, is covered in faces, in stone faces.
Yes.
And they're awoken. They claw at their eyes to remove ink, which is kind of strange. And the thing that wakes them up is the roaring of this lion that's ready to tear them apart.
And so let me get this straight, right?
Okay.
I've just woken up. I'm a survivor.
Yeah.
And all I have is basically my loincloth and a little lantern. Yeah.
And a shard of one of these faces. So a piece of stone.
A pointy rock.
Yeah.
Do you know what? I have a loincloth. That's all I need. I've done many dungeon delving, and a good loincloth, you can do a lot with a good loincloth, let me tell you. So
you can strangle people, which is always good fun. So this is the first hunt.
Yeah.
And as a first hunt, it means we've not done, well, I say the first hunt, first showdown, initial showdown. So we haven't hunted it because it's found us.
Right.
And that means we don't do the hunt track, which we'll see in later videos. But what we do is the showdown, and we have a pre-constructed AI deck.
So, do you want to talk us around the table here? Do we see what all we've got?
Let's start with the monster area. So we've got the AI deck, which has a set pre-constructed AI cards that tell the monster what it will be doing to us.
Okay.
And it's top deck, so there's one card specific that has to go on the top for this intro, and we'll explain why. Then there's the hit location deck, which is when we hit it, we see where we've hit it, and we see what reactions occur and what result we'll get if we wound it, or if it's got us in a dirty trap and it rips us apart. So that's always good fun.
Okay, yeah.
And then we've got this card, which essentially summarizes a few actions, summarizes how you build the decks for the advanced and the main lion for all the other later parts of the game. And on the other side, it has its basic action, because sometimes it'll ask that it does something that requires a basic action, which is generally move and maim someone.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
After that, we've got round the board, what have we got? We've got character sheets.
Okay, so that will be these that we've written up. I'll bring up an image of this.
Yeah. And there are plenty of PDF versions of that. There's the official one. There are fan-made ones that nicely summarize things.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then we've got the gear grid.
Yes.
So on the gear grid, you've got what you can do with your survivor on the left-hand side. So it tells you how you can spend survival points, which we'll get to.
Yep.
And then it has the basic weapon that your survivor ever has, which is their teeth and claws and, well, not claws, but they can chew, they can basically chew on its neck. Or they can punch it.
So they can punch it or bite it.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm going to poke it in the eye.
And then, of course, you've got your gear grid, which is where you put your equipment that you will be making from monsters.
My all-important loincloth right here.
Yeah,
okay.
So and you've got your founding stone, which is that stone shard that you've picked up. Mm-hmm. And, of course, the gear grid's important because much like, I think we can say, like Final Fantasy, where you junction weapons and stuff together to get more effects coming out and to boost stat lines, that's what the gear grid will allow you to do with equipment. Mm-hmm. So in that respect, it's quite simple.
Yeah.
And of course, there's only space for 9 bits of gear, so you have to make
choices.
Important choices.
So I assume head, body, waist, arms, legs, feet.
That's a good point, because on the sheet, you've got 5 hit locations, which is head, arms, body, waist, legs.
Do you want to show that there? Yeah. So.
And you've got a bit on the left-hand side, which is going to be how much armor that you've got in the area.
Yeah.
And how many points of damage you can take once your armor's gone.
Okay.
You've got your stat line that consists of movement, accuracy, strength, evasion, luck, speed. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Then you've got the brain area, which is insanity, which is a measure of insanity. But insanity is armor against all the horrifying things we'll see in the world. Because if you're more insane than the monsters, what are they going to scare you with?
Yeah.
And then you've got everything else that you can unlock. Fighting arts, disorders. You know, you might go, I really like insects, and keep them. Mm-hmm. that's how crazy it'll get with this game.
Right. I'm looking forward to this. Okay.
Sorry? Oh, yeah, you can. There are the insects. You don't want to know.
Okay.
How do we get started then?
So as I said, our survivors have woken up. This terrifying white lion has appeared, and it gets the first go. So who wants to be the monster controller? I think...
I'll give it to Warren.
You're going to be the monster controller.
Right.
So that means when the AI card says it must attack someone, you get the choice of which of the survivors it's going to attack. Of course, if you choose your character, you will get +1 insanity, because that's the payoff that you've been insane enough to go, yeah, I'll take it. I will take this lion chewing on my head.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. And insanity is a good thing to gather up.
Yeah, because certain weapons in the game can only be activated if you are insane.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. So by being the monster controller, I just get to choose who he's going to attack, yeah?
Yeah. So the AI card is drawn. Mm-hmm. It's the top one. And we already know from the deck what it's going to be because it's pre-constructed for this.
This is Claw. So Warren, if you want to take that and read it out.
Okay. So pick target, closest threat, facing, in range.
Okay. So facing is anywhere in that 180 forward.
Mm-hmm.
And then in range would be it has a movement of 6 and you have to be in base-to-base contact in order to strike someone. Mm-hmm. Some weapons have range and reach, obviously.
So there's nothing... there's
no
nothing facing.
There, so you then go to the next step.
So I go to the next step, which is closest threat in field of view.
So field of view is everywhere, and in the case of the lion, except for these 2 squares behind it, that's its blind spot.
Okay. So it can see this character here and this character here.
And it can see those. It's directly behind.
Okay. Mm. So that one we can do. So I get to choose any of the characters that are within that second description. Okay. I'm going to go for me.
Okay.
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 So I have no idea what I've just done, but the lion is going to come over and have a nibble.
First off,
you'll
gain your point of insanity.
Okay.
So you mark a 1 into the little shield.
I put a 1 into the brain. Okay. Yep.
And then you turn the lion to face. So the movement, again, the important thing to say with movement is it's in cardinal directions. There is no diagonal movement.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So that simplifies it. Things a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got a movement of 6, so it would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it would turn to face you there. And, then
and do
attacks.
Turns count as a move?
Turns don't count as moves.
Okay, right. Okay, so it's in, and now it attacks.
So it has if we look at the attack, it says it moves and attacks. This line here, which is a break, those are important at later points, because that's when survivors can spend survival actions to do things to do shenanigans. Like if you do a movement action, it means you could run away before it even gets near you. It goes, I'm going to kill you. And you're like, bye. Mm-hmm. And so you can really game what the monsters are doing. But at this stage, we can't even do that.
Yeah.
We're lowly little new survivors. It has a speed of 2, which basically means you get 2d10.
Mm-hmm.
It has a 2+ to hit, and we don't have any cover. Like, we're not hiding in the grass. We have we haven't smeared ourselves in grease to make the attack slide off us.
I don't know. Greasing yourself up might make you seem a little more tasty.
Well, I guess, but it makes you a bit slippery to grab.
Tasty human there.
Okay. So you roll those 2 dice, and you need 2+ to hit.
2+ to hit. I'm rolling for the lion at the moment then,
Yeah. Okay, so they've both hit.
Mm-hmm.
We don't need to roll to wound or anything else. With the monsters, if they hit, they wound.
Yeah.
The damage that it does is 1 per hit.
Okay.
So if it said damage 2, it does 2 per hit.
Mm-hmm.
So because you've hit, you then roll the hit locations for each of those hits.
Okay. Now, before Warren rolls, is there anything he can do to get rid of this, to actually not take this?
You have survival points, and the one thing we have unlocked to this point is that all the characters as a survival action can dodge. You can only spend one survival point in a round, so a round is the monster's action and then all the survivors doing their action. Mm-hmm. That's a round. So we can spend one survival point per round to do each one of those survival actions. We only have dodge.
Yeah.
Dodge can be used to negate one of those hits, but you can choose it after you've rolled it. So mm-hmm. if he hits you in the head, you can go negate it, because being hit in the head is pretty bad in this game.
Okay, let's see.
Yeah, like I said, being hit in the head is pretty bad.
Hit in the head and hit in the foot.
So,
but Warren has a point of insanity, so that counts as armor on his head.
No, that's armor against mental attacks.
Psychological attacks.
I am a lion.
Yeah, insanity ain't going to help me.
He has an attack called Terrifying Roar, which does not hurt you, but it makes you go mad. And insanity is what protects you against
that. Got it.
So can I use dodge to negate this one then?
So if you negate that, that's good, because you see that black square? That would be where the damage would be dealt.
And I would be dead.
You'd be knocked down.
Okay.
Once all those are blocked out, then you start going to the injury table. Mm. And let's be honest, injury table is pretty horrific.
Okay, we don't want to go there yet. So do I just automatically remove it?
So you remove that.
Okay.
So you get 1 point of damage to the legs.
Okay.
Yeah? And you will lose your 1 point of survival.
And you lose your point of survival.
Okay.
So, the important thing is to say, with survival, all characters, when they're named, get a point of survival.
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll regenerate it through other means. So if you had unnamed characters, they would have no survival points.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very bad idea. So name your characters. I think that's a way of making you actually care who your character is.
Okay, yeah. So what do I do then
put
on this
slash,
sheet?
Put a slash through
this
the light
bit
wound.
Here, okay.
Yeah.
So I just put a slash through there like that.
And that's it. That's the monster.
And then my survival would go down to zero.
Zero. Yeah.
Okay.
And that's your action all done.
Okay.
For the lion. It's now our turn. Right. I will run through what an attack looks like for that. And that AI card, by the way, goes into the discard pile.
I see. Mm-hmm. So it goes over to here.
So once we've gone through all the AI cards, you shuffle and you reconstruct the deck. But of course, those AI cards are also its health level.
Mm-hmm.
So as we do wounds, we'll be removing those cards.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully, I will do some wounds, but maybe, actually, Justin, you're in a better position here.
Uh-huh.
Do you want to move to that blind spot there?
Yeah, I'll move to that blind spot, so move me around.
Okay. What are you going to use to hit him with?
Right, so I've got my founding stone here. So it's a speed of 2, 7 plus to hit, and it'll do 1 point of damage per.
Yeah. Right. Before we move him, remember, we know what, because of the way the game is, it pre-constructs the game for this initial hunt, we know what that top hit location is.
Yeah.
And I can tell you, you want to critical hit that straight away.
Okay, so I'll use the ability on my Founding Stone then.
Yeah. So if you have a look at the Founding Stone, it has an option that you can spend your combat action. That's what the little lightning strike symbol means.
Mm-hmm.
You get one of those per turn, and you get a move action per turn. So you use your combat action. You're going to use that. You're going to sling this Founding Stone from anywhere on the board.
Mm-hmm.
And it says you automatically do a hit.
Yep.
And
it inflicts a critical wound.
I think you want to do that.
Well, actually, what I'm going to do then, I'm going to be clever. Because I know that the lion probably isn't going to like getting hit by me, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go back 1, 2, 3 to here.
Yep.
And then I'm going to chuck my stone at it.
Yeah, and that's a really good place to go because it opens up so we can surround it and swamp it and tear it apart.
So I will give you that.
So it gets, when it says, what's it say? It says archive. It basically means put back in the box.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then I will take the first health level here, which is the Strange Hand.
Uh-huh.
And because I've done that, I'm getting the critical. So critical wound. So you hack off the monster's hand, spend 1 survival to treasure this moment, and gain permanent +1 strength. I'll do that.
Yeah, so if we run through the entire hit location, so the hit location deck would normally be randomized, but the main thing here is that we have a look through the way this card is constructed. You've got the title of what the card is, you've got the reaction, so if you fail to wound, it will do that reaction, or if it said reaction, even if you hit or fail to wound, it would do something.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But in this case, because you don't do a critical hit, it cancels all those reactions, so it doesn't get to hit you back, which
is
a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it does all of this fun stuff, which is, as Justin said, he gets to spend a survival to treasure this moment. You get plus one permanent strength, which is no bad thing in this game.
So does that mean that when I hit, I do 2 points of damage or what?
It makes it easier to wound. So your strength on a weapon.
All right. So hang on. This lion is currently a toughness of 6.
Yeah. So it's now one easier to wound when you when you actually have to roll to wound. Fortunately, you don't need to do that with this founding stone because you just chucked it. And as a result, it has a permanent injury, a persistent injury, which is the lost hand. So this will now cancel the effect of certain AI cards.
Yeah.
So there are things where it's able to grab you and drag you away, and it will not be able to do that. So we place that card in that part of the track. So that's where you put mood cards, persistent injuries or traits.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Okay.
So that's it. You've done a wound.
Yeah.
Remove an AI card.
How many wounds does he have?
Well, this guy's got, I think he started with 8 AI cards.
Something like that. Yeah. We'll figure it out.
So once you've gone through all the AI cards, you then have to do one more wound.
Right.
If it has no AI cards left, it goes to basic actions on it.
Okay.
And that's its final wound action.
So, yeah. So that's, you've wounded it.
Uh-huh.
Is there anything else we need to do?
Not for my character.
Nope. Okay. So I will do my action. I will go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, to there.
Mm-hmm.
I will use my founding stone. So if we go to your founding stone, so we can look at the way that card is constructed. Mm-hmm. You've got its title, it's a weapon, it's a melee weapon, and what it's made of. Mm-hmm. These are all important traits.
Yeah.
Then you've got its speed, so that's how many dice you roll to attack.
Mm-hmm.
What you need to hit, which is a 7+.
Mm-hmm.
And that one is the strength bonus. That's what I forgot when we did the initial run through. Mm-hmm. The strength bonus. That's what you roll in order to wound. So that gives me plus one to wound. So he's on a toughness of 6.
Yep.
And when I roll to wound, I need then, a 5+.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And because I'm in the rear, because I'm in that blind spot, I get plus one to hit. So it's not 7+, it's now 6+. Mm-hmm. So what do I get? I get one hit.
What's
the hit location then, Justin?
All right, so the hit location this time is you've got it in its heel.
Okay.
So you maybe hamstring it.
Yeah, let's hope I do. So like I said, I need a 5+ to wound.
Uh-huh.
Which I do. It's not a critical wound.
Yeah, so you got a 9, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So it's not a critical wound. It doesn't have a reaction on this or anything for failure, so it is just one wound.
But it's got some good stuff there.
You clip the persistent injury keep in play.
Yeah, and it's knocked down.
When the lion starts its movement, is that on a critical?
That's on a critical. Yeah, we don't get that. So it's not.
Yeah, and we don't get the persistent injury.
We don't get the persistent injury. That's a very good point.
All right.
Sorry, we were. If you were done tooth and fist,
you
get luck with that. So you're more likely to do horrible injuries. Yeah. So if we remove the AI card for the wound?
I'm going to remove the AI card now.
Yeah.
So there.
So that's that.
Yeah.
So it's now these two characters left to activate.
So Warren, you now get to activate your character, or I get to activate Abby.
And so if you look, you've got enough movement that you could also do a hit in the back.
Right. Can I choke him with my loincloth?
Unfortunately, no. It's just armor.
Right. Okay, so if I whipped off the loincloth and...
No.
Okay, right. Now's not the time for that, but it will come.
Yeah.
Right, so if I skip around here into the lion's rear...
Yeah.
Okay.
And stab it.
Oh, well, I was just going to... Can I throw my stones into him, or...?
You can do it from anywhere, so you could actually move away from him.
You could do it from anywhere, but at this stage, it's maybe... Well... It depends. You could do an automatic critical wound, but it may be nicer to keep that weapon for later when we might have to fight.
All right. Worse. Okay. Right. That's fine. So, am I better using my weapon or using my fist and tooth?
I would say in this case, the founding stone is better.
You reckon?
I reckon
could
it's better.
Fist from here.
Yeah, you could, but you're definitely more likely of causing wounds with the founding stone.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. We'll save the fist for later. Right. So. I roll my two dice.
Yep, and you need 6s to hit.
Okay, come on, baby.
And you get one hit.
I get one hit.
And where is that?
So Justin then pulls off the...
Yep, this time you hit the femur.
Okay.
So let's quickly have a look at this. The blow lands on the monster's leg. So no reaction.
Yep.
Okay.
On a critical,
Which I didn't get a critical, did I?
You haven't rolled a wound yet.
Oh, I haven't rolled a wound yet.
Criticals are from rolling to wound.
If you critical, you bruise the white lion's femur, crippling its graceful movement. The white lion gains minus one movement token, and you gain one random white lion resource if you critical this.
Right, so what do I need to do to critical it?
You need to get a 10.
I need to get a 10. Right, well, I can do that. No, I got a 5. Was that enough?
Well, it's got a toughness of 6. Mm-hmm. But the Founding Stone gives you plus one strength.
Yeah.
So that total is a 6. So that is a wound. So we remove an AI card.
Right.
Okay. So one more AI card goes. If I get these brand new cards. So that will go out to the wound stack. And this is just, it's able to do less and less now.
Okay.
That is both a blessing and a curse. Because as you whittle through the AI cards, you can sort of plan what maybe is coming up. Like, you know, there's definitely that attack coming up.
Yeah.
Or you can get to the case where it's only got one AI card left, and it's a really, really bad one.
And it just keeps doing munch, 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 munch. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so that just leaves Abby to go.
Yep.
So Abby will go 1, 2, 3, 4, and stab the monster from the side.
Go for it.
So I'm just going to use the Founding Stone.
Yeah.
So I'm looking for 7s.
Yep.
Because I'm not in its rear arc, in its blind spot.
Okay.
And you get a critical hit.
Yeah. Does that do anything?
No. Some weapons do have criticals, but it is an automatic hit for that.
So let's see where I've hit.
Oh. This actually gets pretty deep pretty quickly. So I'm really enjoying this.
I've hit it in the neck.
Oh.
Right. Okay.
So I say ooh because it could all go really well right now.
Okay. So you strike at the monster's throat. On a critical, you roll on this table. On a result of a 1 through 9, the monster is knocked down. On a 10, you've crushed its windpipe. The monster cannot breathe. It dies at the end of the next monster turn.
Okay.
So, roll a 10.
Yeah, so get us a 10 there, Justin. All right?
I'll try.
Come on. I'm giving you all my positive energy. We're all there. The loincloths are swinging. Oh.
This will be too good to be true.
Oh. No.
And he felt a wound.
Yeah.
But no reaction, so it's fine. And that is, everyone's activated. So that's the end of our phase of the turn, and that is the end of the turn, so it's background to the monster, and we pass that count around.
Okay.
Let's think. I am going, because we want to really be in a position that we can easily hit it in the rear all the time. So.
Well, I have to draw its AI card, yeah?
Yeah, go on. Draw the AI card for it.
So this time we have Terrifying Roar.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So, pick target. All non-death survivors.
That's all of us.
Okay, next stage. Intimidate all targets. Roll 1d10 per target. The result is a 2+, and is higher than the target's courage. The target suffers 1 brain damage per monster level and knockback 6. Then you perform its basic action.
Yeah, okay.
This is bad.
This is pretty bad. Right, so let's go round the table. We'll start with Warren, because you've actually got some insanity.
Yes.
So, basically, if this doesn't roll a 1, because a 1 is going to be a fail. Well, no, it's higher than courage, isn't it?
Higher than courage, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So do we have any courage right now?
No, we don't. So, unfortunately, you do take 1 point of automatic damage to your brain.
Okay.
So that's insanity damage. So you're fine.
So I'm insanity 2.
So, no, the insanity goes down.
Oh, it goes down.
Insanity, being insane is a good thing in this game.
Okay, so I go down
to a point.
Go down to 0 again.
So you're fine. I take a point of damage to my brain.
So I don't even roll to see, do I?
No.
What was this on a 2+, though?
No, it's higher than courage, and we don't have any courage, so we don't... Yeah. There's no...
But it has to be 2+ and higher, so you roll.
Okay, so I need a 1 to escape it.
Yeah, we're not going to get it.
Well, you never know.
No. Really not getting it. Okay.
I get brain damage.
Yeah.
All right, I have to make 2 rolls, so one for myself.
No.
I take it, and one for Abby. Takes it.
Okay.
So we all take 1 brain damage.
Yeah. And then also we have to do knockback 6. In the case of you, Justin, your character here hits the edge of the board and just stays there.
Okay.
Where am I? I'm here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Oh, dear.
You're all the way back there.
Yep.
And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Right. Okay. Now it does its basic action.
Right. Then I've got to pick someone to target, right?
Yeah. So let me quickly read its basic action. So... choose survivor in field of view. So that'll be
everyone.
Abby or me.
In field of view.
It's everyone.
Oh, yeah.
Because the blind spot is the only place where you're not in field of view.
Yeah. Mm. So who do you want to give it to? Because this is going to mess us up slightly, because it's going to go after one of us, and the rest of us are going to have to spend
time. I'm actually going to have him attack me, because if he goes after someone else, you're so isolated. At least if he comes towards me, Warren can actually get a hit in.
Yeah.
So I'll take it for the team and gain an insanity point because I've targeted myself.
Yeah.
And it's a basic action, so what speed is that?
Speed 2, accuracy 2 plus, 1 damage.
So they've both hit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I rolled to see where they hit on me. I'll take that because one is to the body.
What are these symbols?
Okay, let's see. That's a good point. So we've got body.
Yep.
Waist. Uh-huh. And if we use the other legs.
Yep.
Hands.
Yep.
Head. And of course, on the die, because it's a D6, two of them are body because the body's the largest
area. It's bigger.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I take one to the body
and
one to the waist. So I mark off a point on my body because it's light.
But we have waist armor for our loincloth.
Yeah, so with that, what I normally do is I just tally off at the top.
Okay.
Because that way, rather than constantly scrubbing out all the time in one location.
Yeah.
So, that wasn't too bad. And then it's Argo.
Okay.
So, who would like to go first? Because from what I'm seeing, there's no sort of player organization.
No,
you want to go.
It's whoever in the group feels they want to take the initiative.
I think I'll take the initiative.
Yeah, yeah.
I was thinking of going around and taking the lion from behind again.
Sounds like a plan.
Okay. So, if I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. And I roll my 2 dice.
Yeah.
Can I use the founding stone, or do I have to fist him this time? Or
you can choose whichever weapon to attack, but the founding stone you're more likely to hit.
Oh, go with the founding stone. Okay, so I'm sticking him with it.
One hit.
One hit.
And where is that?
So the hit location this time
in the bollocks.
In his knee. He used to be an adventurer like you.
Is there a reaction there?
You hit the white lion's kneecap, no reaction. On a critical, the white lion's knee twists unnaturally and shatters. The white lion gains a -1 movement token.
Well, let's see if you can get that.
Give me a critical.
Oh, it is!
Just a critical!
Nice.
I'm warming up now!
So again, we place that there.
Yep.
And
-1 movement token.
It's not a persistent one, so we don't have to place it there, but it does get a movement token.
Yeah, so I will put that back to here.
So we place a minus, that's plus.
Okay,
that's minus.
So you're putting your tokens on this dashboard, not on the board next to the lion.
Yeah, there's. So we can also gain tokens in play from certain things. So there are permanent and non-permanent increases to stats.
Okay.
Okay. I'm a little bit worried about how things are going.
Did you remove an AI card for him?
No, I did not. I forgot. Yeah. So he's burning down. But I'm a little worried about how things are going. So if it's all right, I'd like to activate Abby next.
Okay.
I'm going to have her move. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which is full movement.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And then throw her stone.
That's a really good idea, yeah. Because she's out of range and we want to kill him soon.
Exactly.
So
there's no point hanging about. So I will give you the founding stone.
Yeah, like archives.
That then becomes an auto hit with an auto crit.
Yep.
Just hope you don't draw a trap.
No. So I've got it in the flank.
Lovely.
This could be good. So, wound. Cats hate this. The monster is very upset. Attacker gains the priority target token.
Oh, okay, great. That's important.
That's actually going to be good for us because it's going to draw away from that corner.
Okay.
Whenever it activates.
So, that's the priority target token. So, whenever it says target someone, whoever's got the priority target is the automatic target.
Okay.
So, that even means if you're out of range... they're going to still have to move towards you because you are the priority target.
Yep.
So basically, for the rest of the game, she's just going to lead it a merry dance.
Right.
So you've done a wound. Is there anything else
on there?
It's
critical. So the white lion is knocked down.
Uh-huh.
Oh, wow.
Which means that while a monster is knocked down, all reactions are cancelled and all hit rolls are on a 3+.
That's good.
That's very good.
Okay.
And I need to remove an AI card.
Yep. So we're really getting through the AI cards quite rapidly here now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, wow. He knocked him down. I think I'm going to just...
stab him.
I think I'm going to stab him, because there's no need for me to go to the blind spot. And the way the lion works, we've not witnessed yet, the best tactic is to just surround the sucker and just tear him apart.
Yeah.
Can I suggest that you maybe use your unarmed combat this time, because you don't need the to hit bonus?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, I'll definitely hit on a 3+, and with the luck, then there's a chance I could crit on a
9 or a 10.
Because luck increases the chance of critting, so that's a really good idea.
Yep.
Yeah, come on then. I'm going to gnaw on him.
So you're gonna go in with.
I just go in with your mouth.
Okay.
Go completely crazy. Maybe rip off his jaw. We'll hope that's the result.
Let's see.
Okay, so it's two hits. That's good.
Okay.
What have we got?
So now we have to draw two hit locations.
Uh huh.
So first up, we have his tail.
Okay.
And then we get his paw.
Okay.
Okay.
And the important thing to say with the hit locations is that you can choose in which order to resolve these in.
Uh-huh.
Unless they say first strike. Some monsters have hit locations that have to be resolved first.
Mm-hmm.
And you can have weapons that you can roll to wound and then pick which location you do it to. So there's a lot of... You can really game the monster and tear it apart in a very exact manner.
Awesome.
It's
called butchery.
Yeah, we're on to that 9 or 10, yeah?
Yeah, oh wow. It doesn't really matter which order I do these because there's no reaction. So I'm going to go for his paw. Let's see if I tear it off.
Mm-hmm.
No, unfortunately not. That's not a wound because I don't get a strength bonus with this. And with the beast tail, no, unfortunately not.
And it will do a point.
It will do a point, so that is a wound. Yep. So we remove another AI card.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the last one from
and
the
And that means
pal.
We've got. How many left in
two?
Two.
So
in
if
that
you
pal,
just want
one here,
If you just want to shuffle,
okay,
shuffle two cards.
Yeah.
Say when.
No.
Yeah.
Okay. There we go. Okay.
All right. And now my character himself. Still
I've still
has...
got movement.
Oh yeah.
I'm.
Oh, so you can attack and
you
move.
Can attack and move or move and attack.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yep. Okay.
And if you add in the survival actions, and you can use your survival actions in another person's action, so you can do your actions, and then. If you could make another attack, because you've got survival to do that.
Mm-hmm. So as we unlock these, yeah?
Yeah, so if someone goes, oh, I've knocked him down, you're in base contact, you've done all your actions, you go, oh, well, I'll spend my survival point and get another attack and dig in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm going to run away for a bit. One, two, three, four, five. Four, no, let's, don't want to get too far away. But So he can't just immediately swap me.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I still have to go with my character.
Yeah, we've got this guy here.
So I'm going to go one, two, three, four, five, because I think... If the lion's going after Ali next turn, I'm pretty damn close.
So we're also kind of trying to preempt where the monster's going to move.
Okay.
I think that's it. So there you go.
Okay, right. So you're now in control of the monster, Justin.
Now, because I have two characters that I'm controlling, do I hold this for two monster rounds?
The book is not really specific on that. I would say it's more fun to keep it going round.
All right.
But you've got two people that can be gain the insanity for it.
Grant. Okay, so... AI card.
Mm-hmm. Now, both the AR cards we turned over were pretty nasty. So
this is Claw, so this is the one we began with.
Mm-hmm.
So, I assume because Abby has priority, she is just automatically the target, yeah?
Oh, yeah, she is.
Okay, so the lion has a movement of 6.
So, at the start of the monster's turn, if it's knocked down, it gets back up automatically.
Right.
That's also the same if we had drawn a trap.
Mm-hmm.
So it automatically does it. So it moves towards Abby.
Six.
So 6, which is 1, but it's got minus 1 movement.
Yep.
So it's 5.
Only got 5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, that's a shame.
Can't attack diagonally?
No, that's a crying shame on the monster. I think we're all in a position to gut him.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. May I do the honours and go first?
Well, by all means.
Can I interject there and suggest that maybe I tear him apart now just in case? Because I know the next card coming up on the hit location, we had Terrifying Roar came out.
Yeah.
And that's the only other AI card that's out and still in the deck. I'm going to use my Founding Stone now to get rid of it. Because if we fail and it does that,
clever.
We've only got, I've got an insanity point because I was lucky. But you haven't.
No.
I haven't.
You definitely haven't.
Yeah.
And Abby definitely haven't.
No.
So they would go insane, we roll on the insanity table.
Okay, so if you throw your Founding Stones into him now...
Yeah. We do an automatic point.
Just that's not a trap.
Mm-hmm. And it's
yay!
His elbow.
Excellent.
Okay.
So it's not a failure, it's a straight up critical. So the monster howls in pain as the blow breaks its elbow with a sickening crunch. Non-death survivors gain +3 insanity and may stand if they are knocked down.
So we add that insanity on there.
Do I get an insanity as well?
You get everyone that's non-death.
We all get +3.
Okay, so...
And this AI card goes away.
Yeah.
We get +3 insanity, yeah? Oh, that's really good then. Okay, so...
So, 3.
Okay.
And 3.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that was really, really good.
Lovely.
Okay.
And so now...
I can move. can't just stand there and just bask.
Look at how well I've done.
Glory of this, and watch everyone else get covered in blood. Now I think.
So shall I go in then?
If you want.
Okay, well, you know, to stick with the time-honored tradition here, I'm going to go in from the rear.
Go in on the other side of the rear, because then I can get in on the rear too.
Okay, well, we will share, okay? Yep.
We'll share it rear.
So yep. It's
an adult game, we can share. Yeah.
Right, I think I'm going to shiv him with my founding stone again.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so let me see. Give me two big biggins.
Oh, there two we hits. Go.
A 10.
Okay.
Yep. So two hits. Hit location?
Yep.
The hit
first
location
one is
his beast scapular deltoid.
Oh, right.
Yep, sorry. I was aiming for that. I really was, yeah.
And the second... Ah.
Oh, no. Ploy. It was about time.
It's a trap.
It's a trap.
What?
It's a trap.
So, right. Okay.
Okay, so if you draw the trap card, all other hit locations are cancelled immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And we play this out, and then we have to shuffle the hit location deck fully.
Right.
With this back in there.
Uh-huh. Yeah?
Your character, as it says, is now doomed. That means they can't spend any... You didn't have any, so it's no loss on that. Yeah. But it means you can't dodge, you can't get extra attacks in before it kills you. None of that.
Yeah.
So we run through what it says, which is...
Perform a basic action, target the attacker.
Yep.
So there's the face.
Yep.
Speed 2, accuracy 2 plus, 1 damage.
Mm-hmm. So you get to roll because you're controlling the monster.
Yeah. Come on, roll low.
Oh, both hits.
2 hits.
Mm-hmm.
Locations.
2 to the body.
2 to the
body.
That's
not that bad.
So okay.
You block out your 2 hits there because you've got a light wound and then a heavy wound. Because it's a black box, that means you're knocked down.
Okay, yeah.
And that is it. And those cards go back to the... hit location deck, and if you'd like to shuffle it.
And he adds everything that we had taken out back in and reshuffles
the whole
thing.
Except for the persistent.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which is fine.
Okay.
So, in the grand scheme of things, that wasn't too bad. Obviously... Mm-hmm.
That could have been a lot worse, though, couldn't it?
Yes, he could have rolled twice and hit the head.
And I'd be dead. Well, yeah. I'd be on that wound table.
Yeah, weirdly, there's some injuries can be quite good.
Yeah.
You could look like a real badass if you've got scars on you and teeth missing.
We did a quick run through earlier where one of our characters lost an eye.
Oh, awesome. Right, right, okay.
I'm going to say that's well enough shuffled.
So what happens now?
Well, that's that action over for you,
mm-hmm.
meaning it's everyone else that has still action to go.
Yeah, so it's Abby and myself.
And
you three.
I did mine, so it's down to you, Justin.
Down to you, Justin. Yep.
Can I finish it off?
Go on, let's do this.
I'll go 1, 2, 3.
Yep.
And I'm going tooth and claw into his back, but I have the +1 strength.
So you're going to make your mark.
Oh,
again,
wow. Right? Yeah, you've got this complete macho guy now.
Yeah, yeah. I've got the +1 strength already. So
okay,
that means I'm hitting on a 6+.
No, you're using tooth and claw.
Hits on an 8.
8.
Mm-hmm.
So it is just an 8.
Well, it's a rear strike, so it's in the blind spot, so it's a 7.
Mm-hmm.
Lovely.
And you get +1 on your strength.
Missed.
Okay.
Crap.
Oh well.
Oh well.
Abby still gets to go.
Uh huh.
So move in 1. Mm-hmm. And again, it's tooth and claw.
Yep.
So it's a 7 or more.
Mm hmm.
Oh,
hit.
Yep.
Okay. And then
hit
I need
location.
The hit location. Don't be a trap. Don't be a trap. Don't be a trap. Come on. Come on. And it is. Ah. I've hit it in the paw.
Okay. Go for
it. Okay. Yep.
So that's fine. So this can feel. If I fail to wound it, it'll perform a basic attack with +2 damage.
Uh-huh. Right.
Okay.
Don't fail it.
Yeah. Roll to wound. Come on. Go on with it.
Don't fail it.
Be a man.
If I critical this, the attack destroys the white lion's foot and it loses its leverage, while the white lion gains another additional -1 movement.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm. Gain 1 lion claw from the lion resource, and it's a persistent injury. So broken foot. Ignore the effects of grab.
Okay. Good.
Right.
So. Okay. So you need. Normally you need a 6+ wound, but you've got +1 strength. So
nope,
you need
because it's Abby.
Oh, sorry.
And it's just hands.
Yes.
So it is a straight 6 up, but it's lucky, so on a 9 or a 10, it becomes that critical.
Come on, Abby.
Right, come on, straight up.
Come on, you can do it.
Yes!
7.
It's a wound.
It's a wound.
Okay.
So we remove the claw, because it's the last card in the discard deck.
Yep. Uh-huh.
So the monster is not yet dead, because
yep.
it has its basic action left.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And we take that hit location and put it in the discard pile because we didn't crit it
Yep.
And also the one thing to remember, because the priority target token only lasts for the one time it targets you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that's removed.
Cool.
Okay. I'm now in control of the monster. Yep. Okay.
The monster only gets its basic action now.
Yeah. Yep. I would hardly want to use that on me when I'm lying on the ground.
You stand up now.
But you stand up at the start of the monster's action. So that represents the fact that if you got knocked down by a monster in its turn, then you wouldn't get your action in the survivor's phase.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's entirely wasted, and then you get back up ready for it to chow down on you again.
Should I target myself and get the plus one insanity and maybe use dodge or something if things get bad?
You don't have a survivor point to do.
You don't need survival. I would suggest you target someone that's got some dodge, because it's only doing...
I could target him, and he would have to move, and he'd be out of range, wouldn't he?
Well, it's the basic action, and what does basic action say?
Closest survivor in field of view.
Closest survivor in field of view. These two are not in field of view.
So it's me.
It is me anyway.
I knew it. I just knew it. Okay.
So you get the plus one insanity anyway.
Loincloth off. Right, okay. So that means he's going to attack me. I get another one to my insanity, which takes me up to four.
Yeah. Now, is there a max on your insanity?
I can't quite remember, but there are some bad things when insanity gets high. Like, some people go out to fight.
Okay,
so it's good to be a little bit wibbly, but not too much.
Yeah.
Okay. So, he rolls two dice against me.
Yep. And these twos to hit.
Two plus.
He got me.
And roll to see where. Oh, this could be bad.
This could be bad.
Head and body. Oh, dear. So you're definitely knocked down.
Yeah.
Because your head is taken out.
Uh-huh.
So any excess damage on the body, you know, that's all negated. Any excess damage past those health levels always go. So if you get hit twice on the same place, and you know it's going to take you to a critical injury, you know, don't worry about it, because it's just going to... You've got no excess that's going to carry over.
Yeah. So you've already taken the critical injury for having taken the heavy wound.
So roll a d10 as we consult the severe injury table. And this is to the body, isn't it?
Yep.
Dun, dun, dun.
Three.
That's not too bad. You're bleeding. You gain two bleed tokens.
Mm-hmm.
So bleed tokens accumulate due to certain injuries.
Yeah.
And once you've got five, you're dead. You bleed out. There are ways of negating it.
Where can I put these?
Just put them on.
On anywhere. Yeah. I ain't got time to bleed.
Exactly.
Okay.
If it bleeds, we can kill it.
Oh, yeah. Well, we already know he bleeds. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
So that's done. The lion done.
Yeah.
I can't attack him now because I'm on the ground, so I'm relying on you guys.
Yeah, well, if it's all right, can myself and Abby go first? Because we are in the best location to go for it. Finish it.
Go for it there, Justin.
All right, so myself with my plus one strength.
Come on. Are you going to fist him this time, yes?
He's going to run. Okay. He's going to hopefully run your hand so far in it, you're going to pull his gizzard out.
I might pull something off from the back.
Right, let's see.
I want to... Abby.
Come on, Abby. One hit.
Come on.
An eight. So
it's
that
a
wound.
And that is it. It's game over.
But it could be the trap.
It could be the trap.
Okay.
We could have hit the trap.
Let's see. Don't be the trap.
It's not the trap.
What was it?
It's its chest.
It's a chest.
But it's the last wound.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's dead.
Yes. The lion, ding dong, the witch is dead. The lion's dead.
Okay. Right.
And that is the hunt done.
That's the hunt done. So what happens now then? Because that's our kind of like starter scenario that actually just begins to get us into the game. Now there's a series of steps that we take.
Yes. Yeah? So the next step is that we gain resources from the lion, because we tear it apart for all the goodies.
Yeah. Okay.
So we have a deck of resources.
I bagged you the bollocks,
We've
by
got
the way.
A deck of resources here.
I'll take them in.
Which represent the lion resources. Uh-huh. And we get four of those. Mm-hmm. Obviously, in later parts of the game, when you fight higher level monsters, you get more stuff.
Yeah.
So, Justin, you get a claw.
All right, so let's put them here.
Yep.
Claw, white fur.
Uh-huh.
Warren tugs out a curious hand. So the white line is a bit weird. Its front paws are more human-like.
Ooh, lovely.
And when you gain that, a random survivor gains plus one insanity. One of us.
Well, you give it to Warren, so I'd say.
I think he gets the insanity.
Yeah, when you gain this, a random survivor. So we just.
I think I think it's because if you're playing it as a solo game,
yeah.
you would randomize it. Yeah. In this case, you've got it. I think you should have the insanity.
So I'm now up to 5 insanity.
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. This is great. It's this character feels more and more like me. So
and I get some bones out of him.
Excellent. Okay.
Now, that isn't all that we get. We do get some basic...
I will say, there is a lot in this box, but don't be intimidated by it, because you're not using it all at the one time.
No, that is a very good point. And the box, the tray, allows you to organize this. So once you've got all your equipment and you're building your settlement, you can organize it. There is a point when you add expansions, it might get a bit bloated. But right now, it's easily manageable.
Okay, perfect.
So, basic resources. We get 4 of these. Mm-hmm. This is, again, organs, bones, hide, and other fun stuff. Okay, what have we got here? We've got some monster bones.
Mm-hmm.
We've got some monster hide.
Mm-hmm.
We've got, oh, that's interesting. It seems we found in its stomach, barely, well, not even digested, a broken lantern.
Lovely,
And?
Lastly?
A human skull that was resting in its guts. Perfect. Mm. And what does that say? Oh. A survivor of your choice gains +1 insanity. I think...
I've got 3.
Oh.
Abby's got 3.
I think one of... Because I've got 4, so I think, Justin, one of
I'll
your
take
guys...
It.
Yeah,
okay.
should take
I'll
the
take
insanity.
It. Give me the eraser.
Okay, there you go.
So we'll be using that all these resources to help build items and equipment and weapons, and also to... essentially, you use them to build up your settlement.
Okay.
Yeah. Right, well, I'll tell you what. Let's take a quick hub break, and we'll set up for actually showing how a settlement's built. And we'll be back in a second. Now, this is the part of the game that I've been looking forward to, because I love base building in games.
Right.
So, Chris, you're going to take us through.
Now, some serious stuff has changed here. So if we can have a look at this.
Yeah, let's... So our survivors have now killed that monster, and they've cut it up. They've gone a bit Ray Mears on this whole on the poor thing. They've gone, oh, that's a nice claw, a nice bit of bone. They've found a skull that was in its guts.
They've emptied its stomach.
They've emptied it of everything. They've brought back what's good, and they drag it back. And going through the gloom, leading themselves through with their lanterns, they find some other survivors, other people much like them, cowering in the dark. But also before them is this towering horde of lanterns. Mm-hmm. The only thing that's producing any light of significance, and also producing some sort of heat.
Okay.
And the importance of the lantern horde is that monsters don't come near it. It's the safest place in this nightmare landscape to be.
Yeah. Okay.
So, because we're now doing the settlement phase, you have this kind of chart track that you put on the board.
This thing here.
And you follow through the phases.
Yeah.
And step one says, we set up the settlement. So if we'd already begun a game, we're partway through a campaign, you would build where... what innovations you've already done, which settlement locations. So you put all those in place and you prep any decks that you have to prepare. But of course, we don't need to do that. So we move on to the next phase, which is our survivor's return, which basically says remove any injuries that they have. So any of the health levels, we clear out.
Mm-hmm.
Any persistent injuries, of course, remain. And their
so
armor.
My injury to my head and my serious injury to the body, that all gets wiped out.
That all gets swiped out. All the bleed tokens get swiped out. Your armor refreshes. And the important, this is also important in case, like, you know, people die or you have a TPK. In the case of
what's a TPK?
Total party kill. So much like in a role play game, if everyone dies in a hunt, all your equipment goes back to the settlement. So don't worry. If you have to send people out and a monster is far too powerful, you will not lose stuff.
Okay.
That's really just not fun.
Mm-hmm.
So we've cleared everything out.
Right, so we're on the step 3.
Which is gain endeavors. So any survivor that returns counts as an endeavor. So that's kind of like a resource that you get to spend. It's almost like you've been inspired by your hunting, that you now are filled with ideas of how to improve your settlement. In this case, I think their ideas are, let's build a settlement, but what do we need to do? So we gain the endeavors. Of course, there are ways to generate more endeavors as well. So you can really fast track how your settlement builds. And or if people get killed off, having ways to generate more endeavors is also useful.
Yeah.
Then the next step is the settlement event. Now, normally in later lantern years, you'll be drawing randomly from a deck. But we don't here. It's the first day. So we have a look at the first day.
Okay, so that's this card.
Yeah.
So this is the settlement deck. and the first day. The first day settlement event will help set up your settlement. It is the first event of any new campaign. Mm-hmm. And it breaks into one and two. So one, the survivors wander, drawn into a blooming light in the distance. They find the serene comfort of a towering pile of lanterns and a small collection of scared people. On a deep, instinctual level, they know this area is safe, and they make it their home. Roll 1d10 to determine your starting population, and record the result on the back of the settlement record sheet, which I believe is this.
We've got this. Yeah.
So this is the settlement record sheet.
And it's double-sided, because
there's a lot to record.
This is your bookkeeping log of everything you make, and also everyone that dies.
Choose and record the genders for the unnamed survivors. You may name an unnamed survivor and create their survivor record sheet at any time during the settlement phase. Mm. So on a 1 to 3, 6 unnamed survivors plus the returning survivors. Mm-hmm. 4 to 6, 8 unnamed survivors plus the returning survivors. And on a 7 plus, 10 unnamed survivors plus returning survivors. So will we do that?
Yeah, do the roll.
Okay, so let's survivors? See. Do we want more or less? What do you?
More. Having played through it and knowing what some events that come up, yeah, it's good and bad.
All right, so okay, let's see.
Oh, okay. We rolled low.
Yeah, we rolled low. So we got 6 unnamed survivors.
Plus ourselves, so 10 total.
Okay, so let's pass over the settlement sheet. Mm-hmm. The other thing I forgot to say on the character sheet, because we're returning survivors, we get 1 XP that we mark off on our characters.
Aha.
It's already marked off on yours. All right, okay. So again, you know, they can, as you hit milestones, they'll gain abilities and stuff. But right now for the settlement, we've created the settlement. We turn it over. We've got our character names listed. We've got a population total of 10.
Yeah.
I'm going to fill out the unnamed ones. We'll name them as we need to make them. Mm-hmm. But for now, we'll just put another one as female, another one as female, another one as male, another one as male, another one as female, another one as female. So that should be 5 of each. Because the worst thing you want to have is where one gender in your population is totally wiped out. Because how are you meant to have new survivors created? Because you're creating a community.
So there will be a birth rate.
There will be
birth
rates.
So you're telling me we get to have relations in this game?
If anything, given the notoriety of this game, when you get to the settlement event about where your characters of your population begin to procreate, and that's, I think, important as players, we're not just these characters. We're almost like the deities of this little settlement that's beginning. We're the puppet masters sending them out and inspiring
them. I'm already feeling quite Greek, I've got to say.
Yeah, exactly. When I first played through it, I named all my survivors after mortals from Greek myth. And it really adds to that. I was thinking Norse would have been good for this, or the names of dragons.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, like, you need an emotional connection to what you're
Indeed,
playing.
Yeah.
Okay.
What else was I saying? So with procreating and the notoriety that Kingdom Death had with its models, it's very important to note when it says you go to the event that you have a partnership between characters and a new survivor is born, it's choose 2 consenting adults. And I think that's very important that this game is inclusive and is about building a community and facing adversity. In that respect, it's quite heroic and mythological and
warm and fuzzy.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's a number 2 on this. Are we finished what we need for number 1?
We have named our settlement.
Okay, have we got a name for it?
We've decided to call it Beasthold.
Beasthold.
And because we name it, it says here, when a settlement is named for the first time, returning survivors, which is us, get +1 survival. Now, the important thing to note, if we can see it on the screen, in this bit you have the survival limit. That is the maximum survival that your survivors can have.
Yes.
But it does increase when you get innovations. So right now it's at 1. But it will increase. Mm-hmm. And all our survivors get survival up to that limit.
So we all get 1.
You get 1. It says you get +1 up to the limit of the survival limit.
Okay. Yeah.
So we've done that. And what's the other thing that it says to do?
Right, so number 2. Return to the settlement section of the first story and proceed to update the death count. The first day settlement event card will not be used again during this campaign. So do not include it in your settlement event deck.
So that just goes back in the box and it goes to the bottom. Because we'll never see it again. And nobody died, which is good. So we don't have to mark off a death count. And there is a death count. Mm-hmm. And what's important is if someone had died, we would have to go to this story event here, which is called Principle of Death. Because you're basically asking, how do your survivors deal with death? Yeah. And there are two options on that. Well, I'm not going to reveal it. I think that's for people to investigate for
there's
themselves.
There's a sort of okay one and probably a very dark one.
Definitely a dark one.
Okay.
So what was the next thing it said there? It said the first day, which we've done, we've updated the death count. The next thing is to update the timeline. So we can see on the sheet here again, we've got a list of timeline. We mark off the lantern year and we do the event that's linked to it. So some have events, some don't. And also you can have more events occur per year because of how some are random and may well stack on other ones. And it can get quite busy in places when people show up at your camp and want to kill you again and other things like that. So let's do the returning survivors. So I'll just look to the book here. And there's a lot there. Let's just give a picture, but I'll read it out because it's easier. So the first thing to do is we have to nominate a survivor who steps forward and gains plus one courage. So he is, the survivor has taken it upon themselves to kind of lead the community and they speak the first words. So they almost create the language. So
I'm pointing at Warren because I know he's the first one that would open his gob.
Okay, so you get plus one courage.
Okay.
So that's on the track there.
Yep.
And again, as you increase in courage, you can unlock things. Mm-hmm. There are weapons that actually use courage for its strength level.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
They're awesome. and we also add the white lion to our quarry list, but I think that's already done for us because it's always assumed it's the first thing that
into shop, please.
Just move that up. Yeah, so that's there.
And then we gain our first innovation.
Okay.
Which is this card, which is language. Because, of course, we've learned how to speak.
Yes.
So it has some important effects, one of which is it increases the survival limit of our camp. So that now goes up to 2.
Okay, so let me do that then.
It doesn't mean our survivors get the increase for that.
Yeah, we don't get that until we come back next time.
Until next time.
Okay, so the total limit is going up to
2.
2. Yeah. Okay.
And when you get that, you can place it there. Because that's how you can list where they are. But we'll go through this.
So, and this was all has all come from the book. It's what's said. We haven't drawn that at random.
No, it tells you to do that. Because what you then do is you construct the deck of your innovation deck. So there are a whole load of innovation cards in the game. Mm-hmm. And there are many more that come from expansions and so forth.
Yeah.
And it's your tech tree. So whichever cards you've got in play then tell you which ones are in this deck. And this deck is where you draw from randomly when you perform an innovation action. We don't have any organs in our stuff, so we can't do that, but we've constructed the deck ready.
Yeah.
So that is how the tech tree system in this game works for innovations. And they have effects like the increased survival, they give us rituals that we can do, a whole manner of things, like we can start doing face painting and look horrific, or tell stories to increase our insanity or whatnot. The list is endless, it's ridiculous. The other important thing is it unlocks a new survival action, which in this case is encourage.
Yes.
So if we have a look at that, it says once per round, if you are standing, you can spend a survival point and call out to a non-death survivor. They stand if they are knocked down. So you know when you were knocked down?
Yep.
In our turn, you couldn't do anything.
Somebody could
Come
encourage
on, Warren,
me.
Get stuck in.
And you could have been best placed already.
So do we mark that off then on our character sheets? If we zoom in there, Justin, for me.
Yeah.
So up there, that becomes another kind of little action.
Yeah.
So we were able to do dodge. Now we're able to do dodge and encourage.
Yep.
Or dodge or encourage.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So we've done our innovation deck.
Yep.
And we've got, there's 6 cards in there. The other cards in there, I'll list off. There's ammonia, so we can innovate how
so
we...
So again, this page tells us what to build into that innovation deck.
One, yeah.
Okay.
Drums, hovel, so that's where you make little camps and tents. The inner lantern, which is kind of a spirituality that they begin to kind of understand about themselves. Mm-hmm. Paint and symposium. So that helps you innovate faster, if I remember rightly. So they're good things to get, but you have to spend an endeavor, a piece of bone, a piece of organ, and a piece of hide to innovate. Mm-hmm. And if we look at our collection of cards here...
Yeah, so we've got bone, 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 scrap, hide, hide, hide.
So we can't, unfortunately, innovate...
Because we don't have any organs.
Yeah, we didn't.
Should have cut its heart out.
Should have cut its heart out. Should have cut its nuts off. You know, whichever.
I did Bagsy the bollocks. I just didn't get them. I knew I needed them. I thought I could have made some sort of rudimentary slingshot with them. But
well, we'll get to what they can be used for. They are very specific. So, but the things we can make with our endeavors is we can build some locations to start making stuff out of our resources.
Right.
So let's get on with that.
All right. So we can build a bonesmith.
Uh-huh.
We can
Where does it tell us what we can build?
See here. It's telling us we need to use an endeavor to build these.
Okay, so it has the three items listed on there that we can build.
Yeah.
So, bonesmith, skinnery, and an organ grinder. I'm loving this.
And of course, some of these locations will also require resources and endeavors.
Yes. So.
Yeah, but I'm assuming these are just the basic things you're going to
need. So this is a skinnery, an organ grinder, and a bonesmith.
Yeah.
So where does the cost, where does it tell us what we need to spend to build them?
So if we have a look at here.
Mm-hmm.
You can see it says an endeavor. It has an endeavor symbol.
Okay.
And it says build a bonesmith location.
Mm-hmm.
And then you put the card in place from the deck of it locations.
Yep. So we've now built all of these, and we can now actually start making some stuff.
No, it says to spend an endeavor?
Yes.
So
each of us has one.
So no longer has one then?
We have one left. It's a pool. Really.
Okay.
It's a pull. It's up to you whether...
Do we have any means of tracking our amount of endeavor?
There are extra counters that are generic counters, so you could use these.
But, I mean, does it carry over?
Endeavors don't carry over.
Okay, so we just spend what we have at a time. That's okay, right? Okay.
The other last thing we kind of quickly skipped over is that it's almost part of understanding and looking on the Lantern Horde and having this idea of creating a skinnery, creating an organ grinder, creating a bonesmith. One of our survivors we have to nominate is the one that kind of almost sits and ponders existence, life, and how they're going to mostly die. And sits in front of the Lantern Horde. So we're going to choose someone.
I'm going to vote for Abby so that we can all go out hunting again.
So Abby gains +1 understanding, and she skips the next hunt phase. And there is a little box which says that they've skipped it. So I'm not skipping it, but Abby is.
So... Yeah, I've marked the understanding now.
Yeah.
Okay. So Abby is now like our priestess.
She's
working out how life works.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
So I'll assume for the next hunt we will need another survivor to tag along.
So let's name a survivor for our next hunt.
I vote John.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Let's take John with us.
So if you turn over that and then choose the next male location.
So the next male location, and just put John. I'll put John in there.
Because we've named him, he gets +1 survival.
So we don't have to take these survivors in order?
No, that's just because there may be an event that says we have to randomize which survivor something happens to. And we may not have been at the point where we've named them because do you really want to off the fly start naming 20 survivors?
No, not at this stage.
So that's John.
Need them. Okay, so I'll control John.
John is fresh-faced. He has no insanity, no increases to his stats. And
so we've basically he's got a loin cloth. And said, right, you're coming with us.
So what do we do then? Do we pick a new model for John? Or
the game is not WYSIWYG, so these are the starting survivor... Well, sorry, three of these models are the non-customizable starting survivors.
Mm-hmm.
The blue head one is made using the starting survivor custom... sprue, which you get, you can make 2 male, 2 female, and they look like starting survivors.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got a choice of heads, choice of arms, choice of bodies, whatever. And really, I think the best way is to say, make the models that immortalize particular survivors as you play through, or better represent, this is someone that uses a sword, this is someone that uses an axe, this is someone that has a spear. It doesn't matter whether it's a bone sword, or at some point a sword made of iron. As long as it's a sword and you can identify which survivor should be which survivor.
For anybody
survivor.
Playing this, if they were playing it through, is it designed that you kind of change your model as you play through, or...?
As in what, you can take the pieces off and put new ones on.
Yeah.
People have magnetized, and that's quite impressive to do that.
But that's a lot of work.
I kind of like the idea of immortalizing a cool moment and having that, remembering that moment because I built that miniature after something cool happened.
Yeah.
Seeing him step out onto the field of battle once again.
Okay. So just use a token miniature until something cool happens and you've got the time, and then you say, okay, I'm going to build a mini to it.
And it also means that you can really manage the amount you're building because you do get a ton of minis in this.
Yeah, I haven't put together half the survivors out of the custom kits. There's that much I can use. And the thing is, I've put together mainly models from each of the kits purely from that armor set, and you can mix and match. And once you start doing that, that's really fun. And There are mix and match armor sets which give you bonuses in the game. So there is an expansion that allows you to do, if you put this together, you get this bonus. So you've got armor from one kit, weapon from another.
Okay.
So there's lots and lots you can do in this game, and lots of hobby all the way through. It's hobby, 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 social, social, social with this game.
Nice. Okay, right.
So we've done that.
Yep.
We've got our locations. Let's make some stuff.
All right.
Let's put that skull to good use.
All right, so the skull, what can we use it for? Warren, would you like a skull helm?
I would love a skull helm.
I'll go looking for it.
All right, so we'll burn the skull.
So the reason we've chosen to do that is because normally to make a skull helm, it can cost 2 bone or 1 skull. Let's be efficient.
Yes.
There you go, that's a skull helm.
I have a skull helm. When you suffer a severe head injury, the skull helm destroyed. Archive this card.
Yeah, but look at the armor rating in the top
corner. Armor 3. Armor 3, armor, bone, fragile. So do I put that kind of like
you can
there?
Just put it there, that's fine.
Yeah, okay.
So the little colored thing at the bottom, and you will get these on any of the sides of the cards, are affinities.
Yeah, so this red dot
this
here.
Is what I mean by kind of junctioning weapons, junctioning equipment. So if you combine together the affinities, if you've got so many number of reds, blues, or green affinities completed, that will unlock bonuses in your equipment. Some of these affinities can be junctioned together in particular way, in no particular way, as in you've just got to have a red one, or a blue one, or a green one, or however many is asked for. Some weapons or equipment require you to have, it's a symbol, but it's kind of like a puzzle piece, because it has to be junctioned exactly with that item. It can't just be a blue affinity. It has to be a blue affinity formed through that item.
Right, okay.
Which we will see in a moment, I believe.
Right, well, I think I'm going to kick things off. I'm going to get something built for myself. Warren, you've had some, so I'm going to use one of the bones.
Uh-huh.
And I would like a bone sword.
Ooh, okay.
Okay.
So I want to look at that. A bone blade. So again, it's much like what we've seen with the Founding Stone.
Okay.
It has a
lift that up. Yeah.
It has a speed rating. It has what you need to roll to hit. It has a strength rating, and it has some. It has a red junctioning affinity, and it also has some special rules, which I think it shatters or
frail. When you attempt to wound a super dense hit location, this weapon breaks.
Right.
Archive this card at the end of the attack.
Obviously, there are some monsters in this game that are very tough and or heavily armored.
Well, I will place this here, and I will move my loincloth further down out of the way.
What else do you want to make?
No, I have to do it on this one, because this one's me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Abby, I'm not going to build anything for yet. Chris, I'm going to let you build something next.
I'm going to build a rawhide headband. So we're going to go to the skinnery and we build a rawhide headband. It requires one hide.
Yeah. So there you go. Mm-hmm. One hide.
Okay. We'll put that back in the correct deck.
Okay.
And that's the skinnery.
All right. Warren, for yourself, would you like a weapon?
Yes.
All right. Do you want something ranged or close combat?
Oh, close combat.
All right. Would you like a dagger? Or a sword?
Or some bone darts, so you can attack at range.
Yeah, so you can throw bone darts at them.
It's not my playstyle, so yes, let's try that. Let's go for some bone darts.
Okay, so we'll use up another set of bone.
Yep.
So, again, you've got all the info on there. It says it's a weapon, it says it's thrown. It says
range 6, frail. When you attempt to wound a super dense hit location, this weapon breaks. Archive this card.
Okay.
So range basically means
it's got that little red dot thing.
You can attack from that many squares away.
Okay.
Okay. I think I could do with some armor right about now. So I think I'm going to go for a rawhide vest.
Okay.
So I'll use the white fur, make it something nice.
There you go.
Yep.
And now, actually, this actually works out perfectly for us. So let me move my survivor card across to you guys here. So. What you're going to see here is, I've got my sword, right?
Yeah.
And whenever I put my rawhide vest on, the red and that locks together.
Okay.
But you don't have the blue locked with it, so you don't unlock the evasion yet.
Yeah, but it begins that.
It begins it, exactly.
Right, okay. So Justin needs something with the blue.
Yeah, which would be, you see, it's the good thing with the stores, because they all show where the sockets are on the cards as you work your way down.
Ah! So were any of those, do any of those have a blue socket in the right place?
It would be a rawhide headband.
A rawhide headband. And we still have.
Yeah.
We still have some stuff.
I'd like to use the monster hide to make a rawhide vest because I do want to unlock my rawhide.
But you don't have a red to sock it into it yet.
Well, he doesn't have to.
No,
he just
rawhide
needs blue.
Headband only requires a blue to sock it, its ability. Right. And given that you're big and buff, you've got the plus one strength, you've got this bone sword, you've got the body armor, we know you're going to be running into combat. It makes sense. One of us might hang back and manipulate the monster using the headband.
So if I get the headband, I'll get its bonus as well as my chest armor bonus.
But we've only got one bit of hide left.
Yeah.
Don't be greedy, Justin.
All right, take it.
Don't be greedy.
So that's the hide gone.
The hide's gone.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so then we're left with a bit of bone.
A bit of bone.
I think John could do with a weapon.
Let's give him a dagger.
Let's give him a dagger, yep.
Yeah. And at this point, are you allowed to trade items that you have between yourselves?
You can obviously, at the end of, in the settlement phase, all the equipment gets pulled together and is redistributed as and how you see fit.
I'm just thinking, you don't have a weapon.
Oh yeah, I could do with the founding stone. That'd be a really good idea. Pass over the founding stone, because you've got daggers now, and I don't have a weapon.
Well, he has bone darts.
And you've got bone darts.
Right, okay.
So then everyone's got a weapon going into the next fight.
Okay.
Yeah.
And we're giving...
John is getting the dagger.
John is getting a dagger.
So we have each of the weapon types that will be fit to show off.
Well, can I do something with the broken lantern then?
I wish. If we had learnt, if our settlement had learnt how to generate heat, then we could use the scrap with a bone to create a monster tooth necklace. But we've not yet learnt how to melt metal and manipulate it.
So what happens to it? Does it stay with us?
It's ours. Then? It goes back into that card goes back into the deck. But on the back of that sheet, we write
we have scrap.
We write broken lantern.
Onto storage.
Into storage.
Okay, well, I'll do that. Broken lantern.
All right, now, the one thing I'm going to do, just for a little bit of board game etiquette, the resources we've used are coming from different decks, so I'm going to split them out now and put them back into the respective decks.
Okay.
It just keeps your game clean for the next time you bring it out.
Yeah, this game is really about managing it. Well, it's not about managing it, but there is a bit of bookkeeping, but... Within the box, there's a very good tray.
Yeah.
There's dividers. It took not that long from a fresh box to organize it. And once it's organized, you can keep everything where you need it to be.
So does that represent the end of the settlement phase then?
Let's think.
Record and archive resources.
Yep, that's done.
Oh, so you're still we're still working our way through the phases.
So we've developed.
Yeah.
We've done all that part. Developing is making stuff. So that's the end of essentially that lantern year. Mm-hmm. So we're ready now to go on the next hunt. So we begin essentially what will be the next lantern year of we do a hunt phase.
Uh-huh.
We will then do a showdown phase. Mm-hmm. And then we get to do our settlement phase again and innovate and see what we make from our fresh kill.
Well, you can join us in the next video where we start another lantern year.